Engage. Asta era din cauza, doamnă, pe modelul Star Trek, engage. We are back. You know engage, right?
Yes.
Of course. We saw the same movie. Ok. Let me, because we are approximately the same age as well. Mr. Ambassador, let's go to another serious subject. European Union. You are part of the European Union for a longer time than us, with few years. 2004. We joined 2007. But at the same time, I saw that in the last months at least, your prime minister was quite, let's say, critical towards the European Union, and not necessarily to the European Union as a whole. He was more critical to some leaders of the European Union. I share very much his views, personally. I believe in the project of the European Union. I believe it brought to you. I believe it brought to us, to everybody, welfare, safetiness, and so on, whatever. It is the only project we have, actually, as a vision of foreign policy, yeah. Or economic. But still are questions to raise. And your prime minister was, let's just take one subject, we have more. He was quite critical towards the idea of receiving the migrants and the attitude of the EU with regard as a whole, but especially Germany and the other countries which imposed this kind of mechanism of receiving the migrants by default. And your prime minister several times intervened, he was quite critical. Now, how do you see the crisis of the migrants, and how do you see the management of the by EU, by the big countries of the EU, of this crisis?
It is truly a difficult question, and for me it is kind of disappointment as well. As you know, I served 8 years in Brussels. I was in Brussels during the Slovenian presidency, and Slovenia somehow helped to build the European Union. I truly believe that we are somehow in the crossroads, actually. Why I'm telling you that? Let's start by the beginning. In 2009, there was an entry into force of the Lisbon Treaty. What was the purpose of the Lisbon Treaty? The purpose was to have a strong European Union,
yes,
to have strong institutions, and to have a comprehensive, or let's say, a strong representation of the European Union abroad. What happened? It happened that we have some institutions, strong, I'm not sure, and we don't have a coherent representation of the European Union abroad.
Absolutely.
There are still a lot of rivalities between institutions, between the Commission, European Council, President of the European Parliament, and of course, big member states. They are not ready to give up their powers. So this is, for me, the first disappointment and the first failure we faced. Then came the so-called refugee/migrant crisis.
Yes.
And I really think that with this crisis, we are facing, it is a milestone in the development of the European Union. It is a milestone, but not a positive one. Unfortunately, in my opinion, in my eyes, not a positive one. Why I'm telling you that? Because I have seen since the beginning of this crisis, that many countries played a solo game.
Absolutely.
Then I see sometimes these countries pointing fingers to other countries which were not following the movement.
Let's name the countries, because it's so difficult to...
It's not very difficult.
We refer to France?
I will tell you, Germany for me was an example how to work with this country for a very long time.
Also for me.
I had very good experience working
Absolutely.
With Germans in the European Union. Even during the presidency, I was a bit surprised when Germany opened widely the doors without having, let's say, consultations with other countries. I do understand Germany, why Germany did so. And of course, when receiving refugees, we must do that. We must help refugees. And in this point, I support Germany. But nevertheless, now we opened the door widely, and we are all suffering. Even Slovenia is suffering. So the problem is that perhaps in this case there was a lack of coordination and cooperation at the very beginning of the crisis. Now it's going much better, we are talking. But
Indeed.
Nevertheless,
yeah.
Nevertheless, what happened meantime? It happened that one country started to fence itself, Hungary. okay, I don't like this idea, but we can either overlook the reasons why Hungary is doing that. We had also what? We have also a question of compulsory quota in Brussels.
Yes.
And here, in this case, four countries were overruled, outvoted, which is, in my opinion, very rare. I spent 8 years in Brussels. This question of compulsory quota is not a banal question, it's not a small question, it's an important question. And I do remember that whenever we had a difficult question on the table, we negotiated, we spent even sure. some nights to find a solution. And in this case, I must say that I also hold responsible the European Commission not being able to get an agreement between 28 and not to get on board 28 member states. In this case, the European Commission, I guess, didn't play really a role I was expecting the European Commission would play. And in this respect, I must say that I regret a lot Jacques Delors. I consider him to be the last great European leader, and he was the president of the European Commission.
Of course.
And in this case, truly, I see that there is a problem. Then what we have next step? We have these ideas of mini Schengen. Please, mini Schengen. That's going against the spirit of the European Union.
Of course it does.
And what we have, the next idea is to have to ban Greece from the Schengen area. That's not way of doing. I mean, of course, even if Greece is not doing the job as it should do it, we should ask ourselves why. Greece is in a difficult situation. So we should help Greece instead of pointing a finger saying, you should do that, otherwise you will be excluded from the Schengen area. No, I refuse this kind of way of doing. That's not the idea of the European Union I have, and that's not the European Union as I was fighting for when I was in Brussels.
Practically, you spent most of the time of your career in Brussels,
yes.
8 years, because yeah. it was an important, especially during the presidency that you held, as Slovenia. But now you pointed very strongly several issues which are very important and sensitive for Romania. As you know, Romania was against compulsory
yes.
Quotas. And I agreed with that. But of course, I agree also with the general idea of, let's say, sharing not only benefits but also responsibilities. And if we have 1 million refugees, we were migrants, we need to be have the solidarity to host all the countries. Still, the problem, what you explained, and I totally agree with you, that's why I didn't interrupt you at all, is that we don't complain about hosting them. We complain about the way it was proceeded. We complain about the way that Brussels / Germany imposed these quotas, the way they blackmailed countries like yours or us. If you don't do that, you will never be in Schengen. If you don't do that, we will not receive European funds. If you don't do that, and my view about European Union, as you mentioned, and here we are young people, and we both of us, we put a little bit of more heart in this discussion as we look to the future and the future of our kids and so on. And the future and the idea of European Union, it was never in my mind this. It was the idea of democracy, yeah. idea of negotiation, as you mentioned.
But if I may just add
Please.
Something. Regarding the compulsory quota, I truly believe that the European Commission should do the job. I mean, the European Commission was the one proposing, and it's the European Commission who should pay attention that we have all 28 member states on board. It has been done by the past every time.
Yes.
As I said, we spend nights to negotiate, because of the principle of the European Union. When you have one difficult question, then you negotiate. So just imagine what will happen in next weeks and months when we will reopen the treaties, because we will reopen the treaties because of the reform which is demanded by our British colleague.
Yes, the reform that they are asking for, else they will be out.
Absolutely. But even once you start opening the treaties,
The old wounds,
absolutely, Pandora box. And of course, those countries which has not been taken on board by the past will, of course, come with some proposal, not just proposal, but much more than that. So you see, I'm not sure that overruling, outvoting some countries is the best way to do.
Yes, I agree with you. I totally agree with you. I believe it was a dangerous game to play by some countries, and it will go against them for sure. Now, if I look forward, what I'm trying to look forward, we try to explain it to the people. It's our view, it's your view, it's my view, but especially your view. Mr. Ambassador, we look to European Union as a market, as a political structure, as a security structure. But let's stop a little bit to the energy field. On that chair was the president of the Chamber of Commerce last edition, and we rarely have, let's say, non-ambassadors. But he was so good in making all those analyses, and he was asking rhetorically, and I'm asking you as well, why the European Union, and the big countries especially, not Slovenia, is avoiding the topic of having alternative sources of energy besides Russia? Because alternative sources of energy are many, and we can invoke them from Middle East to closer places. We can really invest. European Union has a huge growth. It has 18,000 billion euros budget. It's the biggest budget in the world. The American budget is 17,000, and that's the biggest of a country. So we could really be the strongest power in the world. So I'm wondering myself, why we don't invest in alternative sources of energy?
I will give you one very precise answer. I don't know.
Okay.
To be honest, it's also a mystery for me, just to develop a little bit. Because indeed we have many sources to get energy. We talk about gas, we talk about petrol, we talk about electricity. I mean, I'm also sometimes triggered why we are not taking advantage of other sources. What has been done by some of countries of the European Union, like Lithuania. Lithuania,
they're independent.
Absolutely.
Importing from Norway.
Absolutely. Yes. They have built infrastructure and they are independent.
A huge ship.
Absolutely.
Transport ship, yeah.
I don't know why. It's also a mystery for me. I know that in Slovenia we are depending a lot on the one source coming from Russia. I mean, it's working very well. We don't have to comply, but I'm not sure what are the prices, if it's competitive or not. I'm not an expert, but I do know that before we get also other sources, and now we have mainly one source. To be honest, I don't know.
Mr. Ambassador, I will give you one example just to give you our arguments to your thesis. One is that Turkmenistan is selling with $180 to Russia, mm-hmm. while Russia is selling to Europe with a medium of $200-$300.
Yeah.
So it's really nonsense. That's why we are here not to criticize European Union, because we both consider this as the main project for our countries.
Sure.
But I understood your disappointment. I understood your disappointment because I also see the hegemonic unipolar European Union rising. And fortunately, as you mentioned, lately the Germans calmed down and started to negotiate and understand that the European Union is not Germany. But I will ask you another maybe difficult question, but I don't know. But it's important for the future of the EU. Maybe I don't know your vision. You will tell the people your vision.
Okay.
Mine it's an individual in Romania, of a person. I believe that Turkey should have been in the European Union already, because it has a huge potential, is the biggest army in the NATO, and we don't really have much of defense in the EU. Is that country at the border of the difficult areas which are now making problems to the EU? And at the same time, we have in Europe more Muslim or Turkish citizens than they have in Turkey. I'm joking and of course overreacting, but it's almost the same number. I mean, even in Germany are about 5 million Turkish people living. So besides the ego of Germany saying, if they will come, they will have the same number of MPs as we have in the European Parliament, or because Turkey has about the same number of inhabitants, about 80 million people like Germany, and it would be the biggest number. I don't see why they actually didn't close any chapter with Turkey in so many years of negotiations. Maybe I'm skipping something. That's why I'm asking you and trying to see what is the Slovenian point of view.
First of all, of course, Turkey was waiting a long time to start negotiations. And then a decision was taken, and now the negotiations is going on. Of course, those negotiations are going on slowly. We just open, I guess, 3 chapters till for time being. Because, of course, there are many other open questions. I mean, when you start negotiating, and that was the case for us as well, for Slovenia, for Romania as well, you have, 28 member states, which must be satisfied, and then one chapter is closed. And you have 28th agreement for each of 40 chapters. So you need a consensus. Here, in this case, you have unanimity. You don't have the, you cannot overvote a country. So you need 28 agreements for each chapter, and not just for each chapter, to open each chapter and to close each chapter. So you need twice an agreement for every chapter.
You were in Brussels and you know that this rule can be overruled, because Germany tried now with the quota, saying that, we don't need the consensus, which was the traditional, rule in the European Union, but actually in the European Council we don't need anymore, because we can use the other rule that 2/3 of the countries representing the population can decide, which for me was really pushing from Germany's side. But
I'm not sure if this rule of qualified majority, double qualified majority, applies to this case. To be honest,
okay.
I'm not aware of the latest, but as I remember, there must be unanimity. But as I said, perhaps it's a new rule, but I would not insist on that. Then, of course, you have to open and to close all 35 chapters, or 37, I don't know how many are now. On the other hand, Turkey is an important partner for the European Union. I mean, we have seen it right now. It is an important partner to slow the flow of refugees and illegal migrants coming to European Union. It is an important partner also in the region. I mean, Turkey is a big country. You cannot disregard Turkey. And of course, it is a key player in the region also to solve some very difficult questions related to what? To Syria. I mean, exactly. We cannot solve the question of Syria without Turkey. We need Turkey to talk to Saudi Arabia. We need to talk with Russia and the United States. So you see, there's plenty of reasons why we need to cooperate with Turkey, to have contacts, and not just because of the question concerning us, concerning the migration, but also to stabilize the region. And Turkey, it's a stable country, prosperous country, and that's the reason why we need to work together with Turkey.
And it has the biggest navy and army in the Black Sea, where Russia is pushing and pushing and pushing. So my question, maybe you don't have the answer. Why do you believe the leaders of some important countries in the EU were not taking consideration advancing the negotiations with Turkey?
It's a very difficult question. I truly don't have a good answer. I would say, of course, there are some particular issues like question of Cyprus. I fully understand. Our colleague, our friends from Cyprus, that of course for them is a crucial question. I mean, the country is cut into parts, so there is, but that's not the only reason. I mean, there are many other reasons. First of all, to adjoin, and we know that, we both know that, to join the European Union, you need to proceed to some reforms,
true.
To make difficult steps to reform true. Judiciary, to reform your economy, yes. To reform your social models, economic models. So it takes time. In our countries, it takes 10 years.
True.
So, and we were in the heart of the European Union, of the Europe, and Romania also. So it takes a lot of time to proceed to that, to get this reform. So I guess that this is also one of the reasons that, of course, working Turkey also has to do the part of the job and to take that steps, which I guess they will do it in the future.
Yes. Let me ask you something else now about your country only. About the EU are many issues to raise. And of course, Slovenia, from my point of view, and not only Slovenia, but other countries are important to be asked before, because else it will be go against the big players, as you mentioned already. Tell me something, how it is possible that in a country which is, I will point out the critical issue for you as well, not only for, because else some people say that, oh, we are friends and we are just applauding each other. Slovenia is a country which is not poor, it's considerable, let's say, higher of the medium of the European Union. And it is a country well organized with good neighbors. You don't have conflicts in the region. You do?
We don't have conflicts. No, we don't.
Because
have,
if I look to your neighbors, I mean, in Austria is not really a danger. Italy, well, with Italy, you never know. But still, it's a stable country.
We don't have any.
Hungary is still stable.
Stable.
We don't Adriatic have, Sea is making you some problems because of the migrants, but
but because of the borders with Croatia.
We have
very good relations with all our neighbors, as you said, Italy, Austria, Hungary. Croatia. Don't forget, we have also minorities in our countries, Italian and Hungarian minority. But of course, we have one open issue with Croatia, which it's linked to the border.
Correct.
We are trying to solve that. You know that there were some complications last month when Croatia denounced the agreement by which we established a treaty. We established a tribunal which is supposed to settle the question of the border once forever. And Croatia was announcing that it will denounce this treaty. That's not the best way of doing. That's not the best way to settle a difficult question.
True.
I hope, let's say, our Croatian colleague will return to a more reasonable position in sooner or later. Hope sooner. So, basically, no.
Yes, I mean, besides Croatia, you have stable and rich, neighbors.
Absolutely.
And my question was actually going on a different topic, and I was wondering, how is it possible for a country like Slovenia, stable, having, let's say, a coherent policy? If I look into your past within the EU, I don't see too many, I see a constant country, too many opposite positions and so on. I don't see extremists or Eurosceptical parties. I don't see that, but I do see something. The lowest rate of trust in the law enforcement agencies in Europe. If I'm wrong, please tell me. I'm quoting now from international standards, and they say it's 2.7 out of 10 for the Slovenian citizens. That they trust the judge, the justice system. I don't know why.
Good question. Why? Hard to say. I'm trying to have an explanation. I don't know the figures. To be honest, you mentioned, but
yes,
mostly they exist. So basically,
figures.
I think that these figures concerning the judiciary system, the trust in the judiciary system is linked to the fact that we had by the past, last years, a couple of issues which implied, big politicians in Slovenia. The politicians who were leaders of the party,
mm-hmm.
And of course they were not satisfied with the decisions rendered by judiciary system, which then has some implication also on the voters. It may be that. I'm not sure.
It is about corruption or what? I don't know.
It was a question of buying some arms. Patria case, very well known in Slovenia because it was some arms bought from Finland, and there was a question of if there was any corruption or whatsoever. Anyway, and in this big case, they were involved some politicians, and I guess that might have some influence also on voters and of course people.
The people didn't consider that the justice did it correctly.
Yes, that's right. Basically, that's the point. So I'm not sure this is the right picture or the picture as it should be. I consider the judiciary system in Slovenia to be quite independent. Okay, perhaps a little slow. Okay. It could do faster, but I don't consider a judicial system.
We can give you for import some DNA prosecutors.
Oh, but you have a very efficient DNA office. So
yes,
I would
that's
like
why
to have,
we want to import.
Yeah, but I would like to
export to you.
No,
sorry.
No, but I would like to have such an efficient DNA office you have in Romania to have it in Slovenia. Fortunately, we don't have it. But going back to the judiciary system, I believe that finally. All in all, it's an efficient system, a little bit slow, but nevertheless, it is an independent one. It's my opinion.
Okay. We need to take another break of commercials, Mr. Ambassador.
Of course.
Sorry for this. And we'll be back after commercials. Publicitate.